This particular aspect, though, it's something which really hasn't been talked about. It's really something that is often ignored when we're looking at the pattern of global, you know, development in the last decade or so. But it's absolutely crucial. And it is one of the ways in which the expansion of the northern economies has been critically subsidized by the south. Okay? Some of you have heard me say this before, but one of the features of the global economy in the last decade is really that it has been the South subsidizing the economic growth of the North. It's been subsidizing it through cheap goods, which are getting cheaper also because we're competing with each other and we're doing everything we can to reduce costs. And part of that, a significant part of that, is borne by underpricing the labor of women in this way through outsourcing and so on and so forth. It's been cheaper labor which is moving. Labor in production is dominantly male, labor in production and construction and so on. But labor in services is dominantly female. And that's huge. That has a very important role to play in keeping aggregate labor costs low. And it's also that the South is providing cheap capital to the North because we are exporting capital to the US. We're all buying US Treasury bills as the safest thing to buy, and we're buying it at ridiculously low interest rates, and therefore we are providing cheap capital for US expansion, which in turn enables the expansion of the rest of the global economy. So there are important ways in which the South has been subsidizing the North. Now, what has all this meant for women in the developing world? Let me just quickly try and highlight that, and then look at that last bit, the issue of international cooperation, which I think will then lead into the discussion. What it's meant for women in the developing world is a mixed picture. It's not universally good news, and it's not universally bad news, but there are significant bad elements. Let me give you the good news first, okay? You see, all of these things are always double-edged swords. When you get into paid employment, yes, it's difficult. There's a double burden. You have to do your housework as well. You have to do all the other stuff as well in addition. And so it can be exhausting, demanding, and so on. But it does give you income. And that income raises your power within the household. It gives you freedom to spend some of this money in ways that perhaps you were not free to do otherwise. And it gives society a better recognition of the work of women. And that's quite important in developing countries where women's work is really invisible. People, you know, across the board in all of our surveys, whenever we would ask both the men and the women, oh, you know, okay, what does the man do? Oh, he works in the field and so on. What does the woman do? Oh, nothing, she's at home. Then you actually ask them, and it turns out that that home simply would not exist if she hadn't been doing all this unpaid labor. Everything from vegetable gardening to poultry keeping to sale of, you know, small minor produce to collecting fuel wood to collecting water to, I'm leaving out all the cooking, cleaning, and housework. Forget all that. But real, you know, important productive activities also often not recognized. This invisibility tends to get reduced when people are paid for any other work. So, yes, it has all these positive features. It makes women's work visible. It makes, it gives them better bargaining power within the household and outside. It gives them more social freedom often. And it also increases their self-confidence in ways where more of them are even willing to go out there and have a political voice, you know, participate in voting, set themselves up for local elections, all kinds of small things like that. Small, big things like that. Okay, however, it's also, as I mentioned, a double burden. It's also increasingly, especially because of the nature of this work, that it is work in very unstable, fragile conditions. And it's a massive increase, therefore, in terms of the material insecurity of that work, especially when it is this outsourced kind of activity. But even when it's work for a factory, because really there's no job security, there's no income security, there's no wage security even in many of these places. In terms of the service sector, of course, it's quite evident that migration can be a liberation, definitely. You know, it, move and migration in terms of moving to a new place, exposing you to new societies, ideas, etc. I mean, I'm a beneficiary of the ability to migrate as a student. I went and studied in England, you know, that I was a beneficiary of that migration. So yes, it can be liberating, it can be empowering. But if it is done in these conditions of distress, especially, it is often disempowering as well. And this is particularly the case for people who go and work within private households, because you're alone. Very often you don't really speak the language. Very often you have no means of, you know, accessing others who can help you or protect you or give you some kind of solidarity in that circumstance. Very typically, because these are women at the lower end of the income spectrum, when they go, their passports are first kept by the employer household. And after that, they're obviously completely within the employer's power. There are all kinds of other potential threats, even to physical security, to sexual security, and so on and so forth, for single women migrants. I mean, all of these are concerns. And particularly at the lower end of the migration spectrum, these are very great concerns. It's particularly important because most migration policy of both the sending countries and the receiving countries, all migration policy tends to be gender blind. You know, nobody looks at the issue of women sole migrants separately, very rarely. Even the countries like the Philippines, where 12 to 1, it's female migrants. It's gender blind, and that in turn means that, you know, the male breadwinner model dominates. In some countries, it's even, it's gender unfriendly. You need the permission of the male in your household to migrate, and they get first access to the remittances in some of these countries. So, you know, there are lots of issues which make the issue of female migration also quite a fraught one for the women concerned. So it can be empowering. It quite often is disempowering as well. And certainly there is the emotional trauma if you are leaving behind children and so on and so forth, all kinds of issues there. So this is a complex case. The final point I would like to highlight, which is not about employment so much, but about the other aspect of material insecurity, relates to something that Raina mentioned in the beginning, the food crisis. And I would like to just highlight this because the extent to which the food crisis is doing damage to female nutrition in particular is something which should make it a global health emergency. And I'm surprised that it really is not a global health emergency. You know, in 2006, well before the big rise in food prices, and before, you know, 2008 was seen as the peak of the food crisis before today, in 2006, there were estimates that about half of the women in the developing world were nutritionally deprived. And this has huge implications, especially for the whole issue of maternal health and child health. In India, for example, half of our children are born underweight. And a very large reason for this is because the mothers, pregnant mothers, don't have adequate nutrition. 60% of pregnant mothers are found to be anemic and without adequate nutrition. That affects low birth weight, and a low birth weight baby has that much lower chance of actually developing in life. I mean, brain development is affected. We are talking about a very, very serious implication for health, longevity, and growth of your brain, okay, in, you know, a lifetime. So massive effect on human capabilities. Now, this is before the big price rise in global food. We've had since then, and that's the topic of another seminar, so I won't go into it, but we've had massive increases in global food prices. We all know the peak of 2008, but in December last year, that peak was crossed, and we are now again at the highest ever level of food prices. And oil prices are still rising, which in turn directly impacts food prices. The things that allowed the food price to increase, like the global speculation in commodities and so on, all of those are still operating. There is major financial activity in the global commodity markets, all of which is pushing up food prices. And food prices now are dramatically affecting the conditions of life, particularly of women across the developing world. What happens when food prices go up is that we find disproportionately women and girl children are affected. And it's not because the men are saying, you know, we're going to eat all the food in the house. It's because the women do self-deprivation. And this is particularly evident in South Asia, but it's fairly widespread. that the mother will say, you know, maybe they won't so much say in every country that we will not feed the girl child and the boy child equally. In India, they will. But in other countries, they will not do that. But certainly, they will tend to deprive themselves disproportionately when food prices rise. So we are already experiencing a dramatic increase in food insecurity and in a direct impact on food consumption that has massive health implications. It affects maternal mortality, it affects infant mortality, it affects birth weight of children, it affects the potentiality for development, it affects the ability to withstand disease in future, and so on. We are talking about huge implications in the developing world, which if this were at all a sane and rational world, this would be a primary focus of all countries, developed and developing. Unfortunately, the international community has been pathetic in its response to the food crisis. It keeps saying, oh yeah, we must do something. Then it says, oh well, let's consider, we'll just give a little bit of aid to some countries. Now, you know, frankly, the delivery of these little dribs and drabs of aid in a situation where just that rise in food prices has already damaged people's real incomes by 20-30%, to deliver a little bit of aid here and there in a very overt and explicit way is actually an insult. It's not just an injury, it's an insult. It's far better for those who are really concerned with the conditions of the poor to address the things that cause such a food price increase, to demand compensatory finance, which the IMF can give, which is there in its rules and regulations, to demand unconditional compensatory finance to all food importing countries that are affected by the food price increase, to ensure that strict limits are put on global commodity markets that prevent the kind of speculation that causes these huge increases, to insist on global and regional strategic grain reserves that poor countries can access when food prices rise in these crazy ways. If actually the international development organizations in Estonia and anywhere else really wanted to do something, this is the first thing they had to do, have to do still, is to put their mind onto specific policies that the international development community can suggest and even demand that would improve the access of food for the majority of the world's people. If that is not done, and instead people say, oh, food prices have gone up, it's all really sad for them, let's give them a little bit more aid and then we can feel very generous and good, I think that's very unfortunate. And I really hope that the development community in Estonia especially recognizes this and reorients the way it approaches the whole issue of aid to make it clear that what really matters is a change in international strategies and in policies that address the well-being of people, rather than providing aid as a patronizing gesture. I think that's sufficiently controversial to get a discussion going. So let me stop at this point. Thank you very much.